let me begin with something very, very basic from first principle. What do we mean by sustainability in relation to corporate?
Well, sustainability, and the audience here has been part of this conclave for 2 days. So sustainability has a couple of dimensions, not just in relation to corporates, but even otherwise. It's basically, it's looking at economic growth. It's looking at growth which is tempered with justice, growth which takes care of the environmental paradigm, and of course, overall, better governance, and in this case, corporate governance. That's the sort of framework in which one has to look at sustainability, whether in the corporate sense or in the public policy sense, whether nationally, whether globally.
So, if I were to paraphrase what you said, this is the effort on the part of companies to be in equilibrium with society and with the environment, right, while also being in consonant with their financial goals. Now, again, from first principle, in the Indian tradition, a human being has four goals, four purusharthas, kamam, artham, dharmam, moksham. For a company, there is only one goal, which is to bring all the resources under its command. Human talent, technology, capital, leadership and vision to create yet more income, yet more artha. That is its dharma, that is its life, that is its salvation. Why bring sustainability as an external goal to the essential goal of making money to a company?
The post-industrial revolution, the whole focus was to flog the machines, the technology, and whatever was available then to get maximum output in terms of goods and later, much later, in terms of services to support those goods. And therefore, at that point in time, for many decades, more than a century perhaps, for more than a century, the whole focus therefore was what you use as resources is not important, what you produce, what you bring to the market. And then we had this very unique concept come in to support the rise of capitalism, which was the joint stock company. And not much has changed over the years or over the decades in relation to a joint stock company. The whole purpose was, yes, you exist for the benefit of the shareholder. You've got to add to the bottom line, make profits, and reward all those who are part of the process, part of the economic journey. But then, not just as a matter of philanthropy, not just as a matter of corporate social responsibility, which are also sort of part of this architecture, I think the global corporate community has realized over the years that, you know, resources are finite, that you need to use them efficiently and optimally, not just as a kind of socio-political principle, but also because that's in your in the long-term interests, commercial interests of the company. So therefore, this whole dimension of sustainability has been getting woven into the business and corporate paradigm, as Mr. Parsati and his other colleagues will tell you who are here attending this conclave. And therefore, this aspect has become very important and integral to the functioning of the corporates. because what material you use, how much energy you use, how much recycling you can do, what is the circularity that you can do in terms of whatever you use, so that you get maximum advantage, commercial and in terms of output from whatever you use. That's become part of the mantra. So that's, I think, the way this has evolved globally, the way it has come to be accepted in India, it's come to be accepted as a policy, come to be accepted as corporate principles, it's come to be accepted by regulators, it's come to be accepted in our case even by finance commissions when they distribute resources horizontally among states and so on.
Now, you began by saying companies will realize that it isn't their long-term commercial interest to actually be sustainable. I can understand that a mining company working in a forest area in Jharkhand or Chhattisgarh would find it extremely sustainable. Actually, it's a question of survival for them. To be socially engaged with the community that has been displaced by the mining activity, try to make them friends rather than order for the Maoists just waiting outside to rally and rotate them against the companies and all for activity. So there it is definitely in the company's interest to actually be socially engaged and help them support you or the company rather than inimical to the company. It is also true that, say, if you take a fishing industry, it is in the long-term interest of the fishing industry to prevent overfishing because you are eating at your own sustainability by overfishing, depleting stocks, and without allowing them to be replenished. But that is, you know, at a very macro level and very some special cases. Why should companies in general be sustainable? If I am a medium-sized operator, can I afford to not be sustainable? Because I can free ride on the sustainability enlightenment of another company which is spending its own money. I could argue, look, my financial sustainability depends on my not utilizing any of my resources for engaging with the environment or with society. So how do you instill the spirit of sustainability in such companies?
Well, you're right to a certain extent that the smaller, medium enterprises look upon it for some part of their journey as a kind of burden or obligation on them. But there are both aspects. One, of course, as you mentioned, there are the external stakeholders and the socio-political environment which obliges them to sort of fall in line. But more than that, I mean, let's leave that aside for the moment since we are looking at the corporate paradigm. The larger corporates which have an integral relationship with the smaller medium enterprises in terms of, you know, the kind of inputs, resources that they buy and sell, etc. This has now come to be recognized internationally and, of course, even in the country, that the larger corporates are looking at extended producer liability. Extended liability, let's say, in terms of waste management, where the smaller enterprises may be involved. So while, of course, the European countries look at it very primarily in terms of from the point of view of the producer, we are, in our system, in our ecosystem, we are not that heavily focused only on the producer side. But that's the relationship between the larger organizations, the smaller enterprises, and that's also the requirement which some of the lending institutions are now putting on the enterprises. So there is a nudge, if not a pressure, on even the smaller medium enterprises to walk down that
street. Now the question is a nudge enough? It's like this. sustainability is ultimately about internalizing the cost of externality. If your activity produces pollution and you are free to leave it just like that without doing anything about that pollution, if your activity depletes water resources in nature and you are free not to do anything about it, you increase your profits because a part of your expenditure that should have been spent on mitigating this externality that you create in terms of pollution or water depletion, you're not spending. So that goes to your bottom line. Now, suppose there are other companies which also do exactly the same thing. And if this guy alone tries to mitigate pollution and the externality that he's creating, will that actually mean a death sentence for this company? Unless policy and the government decide that such costs should be internalized, that the polluter will pay, that water must be recycled, then again the playing field becomes level. In this case, this becomes not so much a company's own enlightened behavior, but that enlightened sensibility being translated into a policy mandate, which is applicable to all companies and all actors in this. So, is corporate sustainability really possible without bringing in regulation and government policy that has bite?
Yeah, of course, there are in the initial part of the journey limits to, you know, sort of enlightened behavior, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There have been attempts at moving policy in that direction. Not entirely successful for obvious political reasons, that the externalities do not get, to use the term that you use and used an economist use, the externalities don't get priced appropriately, which they should. Once they are done, I mean, for instance, why do you have, let's just take the example of the pollution which comes to Delhi, which is, you know, a huge problem for the city, and those who live here have to battle with that for a couple of months, etc., because of, you know, because of power and electricity not being adequately priced in the upcountry states. And so they produce, they burn the residue, and there you are, 3-4 months, you keep running to the hospitals here. So there has to be, and the movement is there, there is appreciation, but yes, on the ground it hasn't really walked the full mile which it should. But the needle is moving in that direction, and I have to go back to what I referred to very briefly. For instance, the finance commissions, which allocate resources as between the center and the state. The last three finance commissions, 12th, 13th, 14th, and now we are starting with the 15th finance commission. So for the last 15 odd years, there has been, and the 15 years, because that covers the period of the three finance commissions, there has been appreciation that there should be recognition of either the states or the levels below the state, which is the village, local panchayats, and so on, as per the 74th Amendment to the Constitution. They should get resources in some manner linked to the steps that they have taken to protect the environment, to grow more forests, which are, you know, basically a public good, because otherwise nobody will sort of do that. Unless who will want to plant trees, etc. You can all have, you know, a slogan that you will plant 10 trees, 20 trees, but nobody will do that in a intensive and coordinated way. So the state has to therefore take care of that public good, and that there has been movement in that direction. I'm not sure whether that has actually been studied, that the resources which have been allocated for that, what has been efficiency and the proper use of those resources. But again, in the 15th Finance Commission, which has just been set up, there are terms of reference which indicate that there will be allocation, I mean, one part of the allocation based on measurable performance in achieving the sustainable development goals. And we all know about the sustainable development goals 2015-2030. And those goals are, of course, very, very comprehensive, but essentially in the Indian context, they focus on poverty, they focus on food security, they focus on energy access, and they focus on things like sanitation, water, which are, of course, primary part of the national agenda. There is also a term of reference in the 15th Finance Commission which talks of taking steps to ensure that climate change doesn't work to the detriment of the economic system, so whatever steps are required for that. So the short point, therefore, is that policy is moving incrementally, somewhat slowly, and perhaps on the ground you're not seeing what you want.
Coming back to the role of the government, urban planning is absolutely key to attaining any kind of sustainability goal. India is committed to reducing its energy intensity substantially in the years to come. But the way we go about planning of cities is so ridiculous. I fear that unless we change our behavior, we will not meet our goal. Anybody who has been to Pune, to the Software Technology Park in Pune, you know that this new business center has come up around 20 kilometers from the main city of Pune. So every day in the morning, a large group of people get into their car, travel 20 kilometers. They are choked out in traffic. They waste 3 hours of their life and reach the Software Technology Park and do their work there. At the end of the day, again, make the reverse journey, stuck in traffic jams, struggling to breathe, losing 3 hours of their life, and reaching home. They repeat this day after day. Why can't we have mixed land use for urban planning? Why can't a Software Technology Park have residential areas adjacent to commercial areas? Why would people be forced to commute such a long distance? Now, urban planning in India has been fashioned after what was in fashion in the United States in the 50s and the 60s, when you had the downtown business center, suburbs where people lived, and people drove long distances to work. This doesn't work. This is a stupid way of planning cities. Now we realize it's more sensible and energy conserving to have vertical cities, to have mixed land use, for people to live and work close to each other. But are there any signs of such urban planning, rethinking, happening in India?
Valid concerns, and I'm not an expert on urban issues, but unfortunately, I think in our country, urban planning is a surrogate for what the developers and builders do. That's been the story of the last 30, 40 years. So they have driven the agenda for urban growth, and that's the mess that we see all around. Not just Pune. Pune is symptomatic of what is happening in all these cities which are growing at a phenomenal pace because of economic and social factors. So this is, I think, a very, very critical area for a country which is going to see major shift in population from the rural areas to the urban areas. There are some numbers, I don't quite remember those, but I think the next 15, 20 years, fairly substantial part, 40-45% or something of India is going to live in some kind of cities. And we have now, of course, the Smart City Initiative, which I don't quite understand what's really smart about it, except that probably there will be a lot of pumping in of technology, and technology vendors will perhaps drive that agenda, just as the builders and the developers drove the agenda in the last 30, 40 years. I hope it doesn't happen. But yes, that's going to be, the urban space is a very important component of how overall sustainability is going to be driven in terms of quality of life and governance.
And to give just another example of what sensible government policy can contribute to sustainability, we have Mr. Mukherjee sitting here from the telecom sector, which is one of the largest consumers of energy in this country. We don't realize this. Every time we take a call, the energy demand from the base station that is on and towers that is all over the country, they consume very, very large amounts of money. The kind of frequency that is allocated to run the service has a bearing on how much energy is consumed. You give high attenuation, high frequency bandwidth, you end up obliging the telecom company to put up more towers and more repeaters and spend more energy. Now, the question is, does this corporate sustainability, does it have to be backed up by intelligent planning at the level of the government in terms of basic policy on what kind of urban design you have, what kind of spectrum you allocate to telecom? Where do we get any sense on this? How can industry persuade the government to see sense on such matters? Again, it's government policy.
What is the solution? I mean, I don't understand what needs to be done.
No, in this case, it's very simple. You should give, you know, say 800, 900 megahertz bandwidth for telecom, which will carry calls more efficiently with less repetition, less boost as required. Whereas if you grant 2300 or 2500, then that will require greater repetition, greater usage. So which spectrum you use, you know, you can choose to allocate a spectrum to defense, which uses less intensively, and another to commercial use, which uses more intensively. So these are all sensible choices with energy. Coming back to another, you said lenders these days demand sustainability. I once had a chance to speak with the fund manager of the largest sovereign wealth fund in the world, which is the Norwegian Pension Fund. Now,
the sovereign fund.
They take money from their North Sea incomes and put it in this fund. They call it wealth fund. It's basically a division of their central bank. It's not a separate fund. Right now, they handle around $1 trillion. I asked you say you are sustainable in your investment. Recently, they also decided to not invest anything in companies in fossil fuels. Earlier, when I met him, they would not invest in companies that waste water or are net consumers of water. They want them to be at least water neutral. I asked him, does it make sense for you to shortchange your pensioners, your citizens, by foregoing profitable investment opportunities just to, you know, pursue an external sustainability goal? How does it make sense? So he answered, I'm so large, I invest across sectors. So if I invest in one company that is, you know, discharging polluted, unusable water into the neighborhood, and I also invest in another company which is using that water for its own input, and that guy has to spend money on cleaning up that water, then effectively, my returns are the same. Yeah. Since very large investors have interest across the sector, it makes sense for them to actually force companies to be environmentally sustainable, to be socially sustainable, because then the returns from every sector can be equally productive. Now, what can government policy do to help our own large investment funds to build such a sensibility and policy into their own fund deployment process?
Yeah. The just to put this in a little perspective before I really answer the question. There are these sovereign funds, and the Nordics particularly, as the House would know, the Nordics are extremely focused on sustainability, protecting the environment, and so on and so forth. So this is definitely woven into their architecture. There are other funds, equally large funds, in other parts of the world, and I'll not go into the business of mentioning those funds. They probably don't have this kind of rigor in their appraisal and the lending procedure. If we step back a little and see the flow of funds globally, a fair amount of funds used to come to India, for instance. We're talking here of our country, to India and to Indian projects, to the government, and also to the private sector from multilateral, bilateral agencies, which used to sort of focus on these issues as part of their overall philosophy and their approach, which was, of course, again, mandated by the lenders. Now, unfortunately, those sources have sort of, by and large, dried up because the scene has shifted from Asia, from countries like India to other parts of the world which need those funds more, Africa and so on and so forth. And that's how the cycle of economic activity, the cycle of flow of funds, etc., continues over a longer period of time. Within India, the attempts that have been made are that we try and tap now from the side of the lending institutions. We try and tap global funds which are available for this purpose in terms of green bonds, etc. We have an architecture, the country has an architecture. There have been issuances of, as Mr. Parsanti and his friends would know, issuances of dollar-denominated green bonds, 2015 or 16, I think Yes Bank made the first issue of rupee-denominated green bonds. So there is a fair amount of money which is available internationally because, in a sense, this is the flavor of the season. So there is money available for this kind of activity which can be tapped to. And SEBI, of course, encourages that. They have their own framework for green bond issuing issuances and listing of those green bonds. It is very important to list them for the sake of liquidity. So that is what is being done or being encouraged so that there is more of money available for the private sector. Then, of course, there are the funds which government operates, like the National Clean Energy Fund and so on, where there is a certain amount of money which is collected from the polluting sectors. We talked of the polluter pays. But unfortunately, my impression is that not, you know, like many monies which go into government kitties, they're not used in a very focused and an efficient kind of manner. So I would say that it's best that we encourage, as a country or an ecosystem, we encourage the external sources more than relying on, you know, the government tapping something and then trying to use that money which may or may not be spent in the best fashion. So basically, it's these non-government or external resource arrangements which I think would help the cause of sustainable development and the cause of corporates who are engaged in that better.
So it is one thing to say for companies to imbibe sensitivity to the need to be sustainable. It's another thing to actually know what to do to be sustainable. Now, for example, plastics. We are all concerned about plastics. People use plastic bags, they leave it lying around, they bring chapatis to feed the cow, they leave it next to the cow eats it, then it dies a very painful death. You throw plastic into the drains, it flows down to the rivers, it goes to the city, the fish is full of plastic. Companies don't recycle their effluents. paints and so on and so forth, all of them have plastic, and ultimately they end up into the basic small organisms that are at the bottom of the food chain at the ocean floor. Now, we know this is a danger and this is something that should be avoided. But how do we do it? Should we ban plastic? Should we regulate it? Should we mandate recycling? So what should be done? There is less clarity as compared to identification of the problem is concerned. Now, on all these issues, clarity is required. Who will provide that clarity? Now, this is again is something that companies have to worry about. When the solution is identifiable and ready to implement, yes, you can embrace it, even if you want to. But you don't know what to do. Who will tell you what to do? Should a part of sustainability resources be used to fund research into identifying the solution?
I think all these things that you mentioned, it's not so much a matter of lack of clarity. I think there is clarity. There is an understanding that plastics should be recycled, that they should be of a certain level, certain number of microns, which is the thickness of the bags that you use in shopping and otherwise, and it's those very low micron, probably below 20 micron business, which is causing the problem and so on and so forth. So it's not really the fact that the problem is not identified, but the vigor or the robustness with which that policy is carried to its logical conclusion is somewhat half-hearted, and I suspect that a lot of it comes because there are, on the other side, there are those fat cats, the producers, who are engaged in the business and who are not easily going to give up their sort of business in terms of polymers and plastics and so on and so forth. So they mount a campaign. I mean, talking specifically of this area, they mount a campaign on how plastics can be, you know, how they are useful or what to do with them so that they don't cause the kind of environmental degradation problems which you are referring to. So in between that, this whole business is lost. So I'm sure my own sense is that in many of these things there is complete clarity, but the speed or the direction in which action is required gets lost.
Now, one side of sustainability is the environmental sustainability. The other is the social sustainability, which in a country like India could be perhaps, you know, far more acute than, say, in a country like the U.S. We have a very large poor population. We have an even larger population which can suddenly become poor if they suffer a health calamity or a natural calamity. Now, how do you take them along? Is this by offering them social security, or is it by creating opportunities for them to leave this poverty situation altogether? And how can companies contribute to this apart from, you know, their own direct job opportunities, which will be limited in any case?
Well, that's the, in a sense, the mother of all questions, I guess it has to be a mixture of both in terms of essentially trying to create more opportunities for them in whatever economic activity they are good at, or in trying to improve and their skills or refurbish their skills so that they make a decent livelihood. And of course, there will have to be interventions, as there have been for the last 40, 50 years, in various forms that at targeting those who are needy or deserving. This has been built into the, I think, the development paradigm at least for the 30, 40 years. So whether you do it in terms of social security schemes, health coverage, whether you bring in a kind of universal scheme, it all depends on, you know, how much resources are available with public authorities and how efficiently those are going to be used if you follow that very aggressive intervention model. So my own sense is that you know, while that is important, but we need to, what's critical is the delivery mechanism and the implementation, which unless it's really fixed, you might really be sort of using up precious resources, which are certainly not finite. And there's no element of sustainability in terms of financial or other resources. You might end up using those somewhat inefficiently. So it has to be a very calibrated mix of building economic opportunities so that they come out of poverty. Don't give them fish, as the Chinese say, but teach them how to fish. And of course, some direction.